Welcome to the Arise Public Forum, Springfield's Climate Action and Resiliency Plan, home of Focus Springfield Studios. It's April 26, 2016. I want to start off by welcoming everyone joining us at home and here in the audience. I'm your moderator this evening, Ward 1 City Councilor Adam Gomez. The Springfield Climate Justice Coalition, the Springfield Climate Coalition SCJC, is a diverse group of community organizations working together to address climate change and ensure environmental justice in the city of Springfield. Founded in 2014, out of growing concern to the future of our public health and the safety due to the impetus of climate change, the SCJC's goal is for Springfield to be a city which all residents can breathe clean air. For our viewers at home, our panelists will be asked a series of questions. Each panelist will be allotted time to answer the question. Not all questions need to be answered by each panelist, but we encourage all panelists to keep your responses brief. All questions, we will have about 8 to 10 minutes for all the panelists to answer each question. Thank you. Now, before we get the ball rolling, we'll start from the farthest panelist, and please introduce yourself to our studio audience and our viewers at home.
I'm Michael-Ann Busey. I'm the director of Arise for Social Justice in Springfield.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jesse Letterman. I'm a member of the group Stop Toxic Incineration in Springfield, and I'm also the environmental organizer with Arise for Social Justice and a lifelong resident of the city of Springfield.
Good evening. My name is Yvette Hernandez. I'm a North End resident, and I am part of the board of Keep Springfield Beautiful.
Hi, I'm Claire Miller. I'm lead community organizer with Toxics Action Center and a founder of the statewide coalition Mass Power Forward.
Before we move on with our questions, we're going to be passing out cards and pencils, and you can write your question, and at the end, our staff will go through them and ask some of those questions to our panelists. So just hold tight. We'll be right with your questions as soon as we get done with our first part of our program. Well, first, addressing the threat of global climate change. Why is it important to find solutions to global climate change? Not necessarily anybody can go first, but you guys can just jump right in.
Well, I will jump in. I want a planet that we can all continue to live on. I was thinking about this as I was getting ready for the panel, and even if it were not true that human beings are having a huge impact on climate change, even if the deniers were right and it was largely just part of a natural cycle, we know that burning fossil fuels exacerbates that. I mean, plagues and pandemics are part of a natural cycle also, but that doesn't mean we don't try to come up with vaccines and treatment for people. We don't shrug and say, oh, well, that's just part of the natural cycle. You know, we're part of this planet. We live on this planet, and we have a responsibility to take care of it, because if we take care of the planet, she will take care of us.
Jesse?
No, I think one of the really important things to recognize about global climate change, and something that we deal with in Springfield a lot, is the fact that the effects of global climate change are becoming much more localized. And while the warming atmosphere is a problem, rising sea levels are going to be a problem, those same pollutants that are causing that or contributing to that are also impacting the public health and quality of life of residents in Springfield and the surrounding communities and all across the United States and around the world. And so global climate change is not this unrelatable thing for people, especially today. It's something that's impacting their everyday lives, their children's lives, their parents' lives. And so that's why it's something that, you know, we're seeing in Springfield much more action around. And I think we're going to start to see that again in other communities as well.
Claire? Awesome. Next question. Who does climate change affect the most? And how does this relate to Springfield?
So I want to speak for the North End. I am a single mother of three children, three of which were born with asthma. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a couple of them were able to outgrow it, but one remained with chronic asthma, and this affected the ability to attend school every single day. And as we know, 12, 15 absences, and they call the Department of Children and Families, and you're in trouble, and you're truant, and you know, many, many other issues related to that. And not to mention the time off from work for me to be able to care for an ill child. You know, it was because of one of my children that I became more and more aware of what actions I could take to be more proactive against this and to fight back global warming and climate change. And my son Moses, who became part of gardening the community, you know, explained to me that, you know, even if you wanted to grow fruits and vegetables, you still have to test your soil. And if your soil is like filled with toxins, you can't be growing your own food and vegetables. And as a resident who came from, I was born and raised in Puerto Rico, that's what we love to do. We love to raise our own fruits and vegetables, and to even know that, you know, our soil is filled with so many toxins that are so, that can cause so much harm to us, is devastating. I have one story that I would like to share. One time I was driving down the highway and I saw trucks going one way towards like Chicopee, Holyoke, and I live in the North End. And as I was like driving behind them, these trucks were spraying what appeared to be pesticides over the North End residents. And that, after that day, I, you know, told myself that I needed to get more involved. It was about a week later that it went on the news that they were spraying and, you know, asked that the residents, especially elderly and children, remain closed doors. Nevertheless, my neighborhood was not notified, especially not notified in my language, in Spanish, where the residents could definitely come inside. And this is something that, you know, it goes from every single one of us to politicians, to leaders, to, you know, from local to, you know, statewide. And yeah, we have to take actions.
Thank you. Anybody on the panel want to answer the question?
I just want to add very simply, and I think Yvette illustrated it very beautifully, the people most impacted by climate change are the most vulnerable, which means our elderly, it means our children, it means folks who, you know, can't necessarily afford to pay even bigger heating bills in the cold when it gets cold, or bigger air conditioning bills when the heat waves come. It's the most vulnerable.
Thank you, Claire. Anybody else on the panel want to add to that?
Yeah, well, what I think Claire and Yvette are demonstrating very eloquently is really the concept of environmental justice. Environmental justice is the idea that while climate change and public health crises affect everybody around the world, everybody across Massachusetts and across Springfield, they especially impact low-income communities and communities that are more vulnerable to these types of injustices. And so the concept of environmental justice and what we work on so hard at Arise and with our Springfield Climate Justice Coalition is to really reach out into those neighborhoods and hold the city accountable, hold our leaders accountable, and empower the residents themselves to stand up in the face of these challenges.
Great. Anybody else? No? We're going to move on. In our local sustainability campaigns in Springfield, there's a lot of campaigns going on in Springfield with the Climate Justice Coalition. I'm going to ask you another round of questions. And like I said, not everybody has to answer them, but if you guys feel the need, you can just jump right in. The City of Springfield has committed to creating a climate action and a resiliency plan. Why is this necessary and significant?
Yeah, I'll jump in on this one. Funding does have a lot to do with why the city has made this commitment. But I will say community organizing does also. We started out with rallies and asked the city council at the time to take climate change seriously. We asked the mayor to please hire a coordinator, because right now in the city of Springfield, sometimes the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. So one department will do something positive and another department will undo it accidentally. Mm-hmm. So no, we really can't afford to waste our resources like that. But But after we organized for a while and had rallies and sent postcards to the mayor, a funding opportunity came along that Springfield, I have to say, unfortunately, was really in the lead for because of the number of natural disasters that we have experienced in the last 5 or 6 years. Mm-hmm. So this particular grant was only for states and cities. In fact, we were the only city to be funded by HUD to address some of the issues that relate to resiliency. Resiliency being a term that's being used more and more often, that means how do you survive climate change? How do you adapt to climate change? But of course, what we're really interested in is how do you limit the effects of climate change as much as we possibly can. And within that grant, there was a small amount of money designated for the city to develop a climate change plan. We met with the city and said, we don't want a climate change plan. We want a climate justice plan. And somewhat to our surprise, the city went along with that. And I think that the proof will be in the pudding. We'll see how it all plays out. But we want the communities that have been most affected to be the beneficiaries of solutions and to make sure that our voices are heard as this plan is shaped.
Anybody else on the panel want to add to that?
Yeah, well, you know, Adam, I remember last October, or maybe almost a year and 2 years ago, I spoke before your colleagues on the city council, this was prior to your election, when we pushed the resolution for a climate action plan in Springfield. And I think that in Springfield, all too often, we look at some of the problems that our city faces and we throw our hands up. And we say, well, we have some folks who say this is, you know, the scourge of urban America. And that's true. The issues that Springfield faces are issues that urban communities across the United States face. But what I've always said is that that does not mean, and there's no reason for Springfield to not be a leader in addressing those issues. And so when I talked before the council a couple Octobers ago, 2 years ago, I said I was so glad to finally be standing up on a proactive issue. And I think we have a lot to be proud of in Springfield with this climate action and resiliency planning process that we're going through. Other communities have done this, but not all communities are. And in the region, we're really paving the way for it. So it's a huge congratulations to the folks that pushed it through. This was prior to my time joining Arise in any official capacity. And so I think, again, we just have a lot to be proud of here in Springfield, and it's an example to set for communities across the United States.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to add to that?
As my colleagues had mentioned, and I am so proud with all the work that we have done, but this is only the beginning. We have so many work that we still need to do when it comes to climate change. And I can speak a little bit more as a resident, again, of the North End. You know, we have a community, a neighborhood, where you have the river, you have the highway, and then you have the train tracks, all, you know, in one area affecting all these residents. And then we have it also where it's affecting, an elementary school where, you know, we have organizers and leaders in the North End that are coming together to address this issue because it is environmental, because it does affect the children. And to still have a school where children are getting sick because of the condition of the school in 2016 in the U.S., I find it very unacceptable. And so we still have to push forward and that, you know, make sure that it is affecting communities of color and those that are impoverished and oppressed, and I want to make sure that, you know, that those fundings do reflect the community as well and do reach out to those communities because it's the least that we can do for our residents.
Claire?
Yeah, I just wanted to add, for folks who maybe haven't spent a lot of time staring at climate science, what the scientists say that we can expect here in New England is more rain, more snow. So when you think about more snow, you know, that winter when we had to shovel and shovel and shovel, you know, that can have real impacts, and Springfield can get ahead of that. Can think about better public transportation, that can be real planning, real climate justice. When you think about rain, that can also really impact housing, can impact mold, that can impact your respiratory system, asthma. So it's really incredible that the city is planning ahead for this, trying to do its part to not contribute to make it worse, and then plan ahead to protect its residents and really get through that as best as possible.
Well, leading into what you said, our next question is, what does the term environmental justice mean to you?
Again, it's going back to making sure that those communities where parents have to wake up and worry about more about what they're going to feed their children and can't even think about, you know, the environment itself, you know, the bigger picture of how, you know, our climate is affecting us, but they're so in tune and so worried about, you know, where am I going to sleep and what am I going to eat? We need to make sure that we inform them and educate them that, you know, that there's a proactive approach that we can take together in trying to fight this. There's a way for us, or making sure that there's a way for all of us to work together with those public buildings and public land where it's also being taken care of. I've had the opportunity to knock on doors and you know, to hear families who are living in low-income apartments, elderly who are on top of the building and the building is not insulated and the heat is so strong they cannot bear being inside their apartment. And they're not allowed to have air conditioner because it's low income. I mean, there's so many things that we do to people and don't realize that we're just like putting them like they're nothing, they're less than humans, and it's not right. And that's for me, all of us being here and taking an action against that, that's what I call a climate justice.
All right, anybody want to add to that?
Well, to me, environmental justice means that the poorest neighborhood in Springfield should not have to worry anymore about environmental impacts, public health crises, climate issues than the wealthiest neighborhood in Springfield. And Yvette alluded earlier to the issues that have been going on for, you know, close to two decades at the Herrera Community School in the North End. And Adam, I know you and I both spoke at a rally about 2 weeks ago. There are new organizations coming together to work on the issues that have happened at Herrera School. And for those of you that aren't familiar with Herrera, Herrera is a school in the north end of Springfield. The north end of Springfield is one of the poorest communities in our region. And it was built as a community school. It has an amazing history. It is the only community space that exists in the North End, and it's very near and dear to the residents of the North End. But it's also a school that, given where it's built under the river line of the Connecticut River, underneath the 91 overpass, that has had some real environmental challenges. And there's an EPA report from 2014 that we've been looking over that shows some of the issues that children that attend that school have been going through. And a lot of those children are children from the North End, children from low-income families. Mm-hmm. Here's sort of the brunt of it. That wouldn't happen in other neighborhoods in our city. It doesn't happen in other neighborhoods in our city. It doesn't happen in other cities in our region. And so environmental justice is coming to the table and saying out loud that that is wrong and that we are going to address that through legislative tactics, through activist tactics, through community organizing.
Anybody else want to add to that?
I'll just say, to me, very simply, environmental justice means no matter your color, your income, your gender, where you live, you deserve a healthy place to live, work, play, go to school, worship, run a business. Doesn't matter. We all deserve that.
Great.
Yeah, I guess I'd add one thing. Environmental justice should also mean that those that have benefited from pollution should pay a higher price to address it. It may be a burden that we all share, but some people share, some corporations and businesses share, should be larger than others.
Right on.
Thank you
for your answers. Next question. As you may know, hundreds of communities across the United States have banned the use of single-use plastic bags, including a dozen in Massachusetts. What are the benefits of a plastic bag ban, and how would it work in Springfield?
I'm gonna cover that.
Sure. So one of the campaigns that the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition and that Arise for Social Justice has recently started working on and exploring is a ban of single-use plastic bags across the city. And so that's an idea that when people first hear it, they're usually very intimidated by. We are extremely accustomed to receiving a single-use plastic bag with almost every purchase that we make. I went to a retailer last night and purchased one thing of berries that wasn't much bigger than this cup. They gave me a bag for it. I took the bag. I didn't think twice about it. However, if you actually look at the impact that these single-use plastic bags have, it's actually very great. From the simplest thing to, I know we have the Keep Springfield Beautiful cleanup coming up this Saturday. Guarantee if you go through the cleanup sites, you're going to find a lot of plastic bags. They are a huge source of litter throughout the city. There's also environmental impacts. Animals eat the bags. Birds are feeding the bags to their babies unknowingly. The baby birds are dying. Not to mention the amount of bags that are now ending up in our oceans. And what ends up in our oceans ends up in our fish. And who eats the fish? We do. And so after looking into this a lot more, it's a campaign that we've started to pursue. There are a number of communities across Massachusetts that have done this and hundreds of cities across the United States, including some big cities like Washington, D.C. More locally, right up the highway in Northampton, they've banned the use of single-use plastic bags. What's really important for us as a community organization in talking about this is we want to make sure that if this ban is implemented, that it's not going to adversely and more greatly impact low-income individuals and small businesses. And so we're exploring ways to make craft the ordinance in such a way that smaller businesses who would face a burden from transitioning over will have more time to transition over, be guided in their transition. And also, you know, at this time, we're not considering any sort of fee on other bags that would otherwise be available. So some communities impose a fee. That's something that we feel would more greatly impact low-income communities.
I guess I would add, too, is there's a cost to municipalities for using plastic bags. Although it doesn't get a lot of publicity, they clog storm drains and cause lots of flooding and backup, and the city has to pay the price for that. We're having an intern start with Arise in a couple of weeks from Uganda. Uganda has completely banned the use of plastic bags in their whole country, mostly so that they can control flooding and preserve water where it needs to be preserved and not have flooded streets and agricultural lots. So if they can do it, we can do it.
All right, we're going to move on to our next question. For the last several years, developers have been attempting to construct a biomass waste incinerator in East Springfield, but have been stopped by the work of local activists and elected officials. Why has the biomass incinerator faced such opposition, and what would its impact be on Springfield?
Well, first I have to say, because I know if the developers were here, they would definitely, and they wanted to be here, I hear, they would definitely say that the biomass incinerator meets all state requirements for clean air, and this is true. Unfortunately, the requirements are not strict enough, the standards are not high enough, and you will never hear a developer say that it won't pollute at all. In fact, I met with one of the developers early on in this campaign, and I said to him, so can you tell me that not a single person in Springfield will be harmed by the biomass plant? And he said, no, I can't say that. We know that it will contribute to climate change. We know that the pollutants that will be emitted, including lead, mercury, a number of other heavy metals and other toxins, are not good in any quantity. You know, there are federal standards for lead, but if you ask the EPA, they'll say outright, no level of lead is a safe level. And lead does accumulate in trees, unfortunately, because it's a pollutant and it winds up in the soil and trees soak it up. So, I mean, I could say a lot about why biomass is not a good idea for Springfield. If I'm going to link it with the larger issue of climate change, one of the things that our organizing did accomplish fairly early on was the developers were saying that biomass is a renewable energy. In other words, you burn a tree, well, you can grow a tree. It takes about 20 years for a tree to reach the size where it's actually harvestable. But 20 years from now, we're going to be in so much trouble about climate change that it just doesn't make sense to use that kind of a time frame when we're addressing climate change. On top of that, really, if we don't get away from burning fossil fuels, burning anything for energy is the wrong way to go. We've got the sun, we've got wind, we've got water power. We do not need to be burning anything to create our energy. I know when we first started this campaign, when we first started to hear about it, was the same week that one of our members, a 23-year-old cousin, died from an asthma attack. And that always stuck in my mind about, you know, biomass, it's not some very abstract issue. You know, it's an issue that affects people's lives and people's well-being. The community doesn't want it. The developers want it because they think they'll make some money. I'm not so sure that they will, but they're very stubborn. And we're going to fight them to the bitter end, and hopefully it'll be better for them and not for us.
I want to add a couple things to that. First, Springfield is a city that has one of the highest, it has one of the highest asthma rates in children in the Commonwealth. It has one of the highest asthma rates in children in the United States. Last time I checked, over 20% of our school children in Springfield suffer from asthma or other respiratory issues. At the same time as the permit for the biomass incinerator was granted back in 2008, which has since been rescinded, the special permit, Hamden County received an F for its air quality from the American Lung Association. Now, a couple years later, we went up, we got a C, and just recently, we're back down to an F. So we're living in the Pioneer Valley, which is a valley where air gets trapped, and so we're more susceptible to pollutants that are put into the air because they sit between the mountains. And this is not just an issue for Springfield. It's an issue for the entire Pioneer Valley, which is why many communities surrounding Springfield, their legislative bodies have also passed resolutions in opposition to the biomass incinerator. But I also think that the biomass incinerator is a perfect example of why environmental justice and activism around environmental justice is important. So a little bit of history on the biomass incinerator. When we found out about it 6 years ago, and we're pretty active people, I think, in the community. I was on a neighborhood council at the time. Yvette's involved. Michael Ann's, you know, very involved. They had almost every permit they needed. They had all their local permits. They had almost all their state permits. They were set to build this incinerator. And very few people knew about it. And that's because this incinerator was passed by a 7-2 vote of the Springfield City Council. On the agenda, it was listed as a recycling center, if I remember correctly. And a lot of councilors claimed later on they didn't really know what they were voting for. And that's why the City Council repealed the special permit a couple years later when the information as to what this incinerator really was came to light. That's why almost every neighborhood council across Springfield has voted in opposition to it. And that's why now the vast majority of Springfield city councilors are in vocal opposition to it. It's worth noting, though, that there are city councilors in the city of Springfield and elected officials in the city of Springfield that still support the construction of this incinerator, that have accepted campaign contributions from the developers of this incinerator. And so money in politics is a very real thing. It gets local. And I think that that's why it's so important for communities to be engaged, to follow these tracks and follow where these things come from. And I think that, you know, again, though, it's a testament to community organizing, because, you know, we had some legal help and we had some professionals come in, but the biggest reason that this incinerator hasn't been built in 6 years is because hundreds of Springfield residents who came from very diverse backgrounds, some were wealthy, some were as poor as you can get, black, white, Hispanic, every color you can think of, showed up by the hundreds to community meetings and to hearings and said, we don't want this in our community, and we have a say in what gets built in this city. And they were successful. So it's a good lesson to learn on projects like this.
I'm going to add something, but then I'm going to call on Claire, because she is actually one of those experts who came in to get us to organize. We knew nothing, absolutely nothing. Even the alphabet soup of state agency initials, who was responsible for what. I remember when I was going on the city website or the state website, and I found my first reference to environmental justice. And it required that developers that were going to produce more than 35 megawatts or megawatts of energy get a special kind of permit. And it defines Springfield as an environmental justice community. First time I'd ever heard that expression. I didn't know what it was. And I thought, we're saved. We're saved. Somehow the developers got a permit, and they're in violation of state law. Well, as it turned out, the developers were very clever. Their plant's proposal was for a 33-megawatt plant, just under what would have triggered a larger environmental review. And in our stumbling around and calling up everybody we could possibly think of, the two groups that really shone were the Conservation Law Foundation in Boston and the Toxics Action Center that Claire was our organizer at the time.
Claire, before you add two cents, I just had a question on, other than that biomass plant, is there a cleaner way to that Springfield can use to, you know, it's just we continuously hear about this biomass plant, but if there's another way or something else that we can bring into the city that is cleaner, can you just tell some of the viewers about that?
Can I give you one example? Because right now, and I talked about this resiliency grant that the city got. One of the things they're going to do is turn Watershops Pond into a hydroelectric generator, so that the next time we have a catastrophe like a tornado, the city will not be cut off from electricity, and it will have this independent source of energy that it can use. But people should understand this electricity is not going to benefit Springfield. It's not going to lower our rate. The electricity that's produced will be sold to the grid, and the grid is driven by market forces.
Yeah, there's a couple thoughts I want to share.
No problem. Share your thoughts, just a question.
So the first is folks have probably heard a little bit about gas pipeline proposals for Massachusetts, and there's been a lot of conversation about what do we need to keep the lights on? And our Attorney General, Maura Healey, actually commissioned a study to look into this question, specifically around pipelines, these massive proposals to bring in gigantic amounts of fracked gas down, you know, coming up from the Marcellus Shale. And that study took months, and it was very thorough and very solidly came back with the answer, no, we do not need new fossil fuel pipelines. And in fact, the very best thing we could be doing is continuing to invest in energy efficiency. Let's actually, you know, make our homes more, you know, keep the heat inside or keep the cool inside, depending on what season it is. Let's actually invest in making sure that we're able to use the energy that we have. That's the first thought. One of my favorite clean energy facts, which still blows my socks off when I think about it, is that enough sunshine comes down on planet Earth in 1 hour to power the entire world for a year. So if you can just wrap your brain around that, the power of the sun, if we could put a solar panel on every roof, over every parking lot, we could generate so much electricity for Springfield. We just have to actually put our energy there. The thing about the biomass plant, that proposal was one of a handful here in New England during a time when it seemed, you know, people kind of had this idea that burning trees was somehow renewable, and it was almost a fad. There was like a rash of them. We saw one in Russell. We saw another one up in Greenfield, which have since declined. This one is still stubborn.
And it's telling that the developers left their site assignment with the Public Health Council for last, because it is going to be one of, I think, the hardest permits for them to win. They actually have to make the case that somehow this incinerator, which will put, you know, tons of soot into the air, somehow will not impact the health of Springfield residents. I think we are very poised and ready to make the case that it absolutely will impact the health of residents, and I'm excited to see Springfield's Public Health Council uphold that truth and deny a site assignment permit.
I'm going to move on to the next question. And a recent campaign has been launched urging Columbia Gas to repair of 500 gas leaks in Springfield. Why are these gas leaks significant, and what are their contribution to public health and climate change?
I wanted to just continue with you know, what we've been talking about to add to the gas leak. You know, I've been very fortunate that I had the opportunity to attend the meetings, SCJC meetings, for over a year now, and I have learned a tremendous amount with all the information that it's provided in those meetings, you know, to include the pipeline and how that would impact, and how, you know, if it passed, we would have little to say as homeowners or you know, as you know, lobbyists or whatever, activists, because once it's done, they take advantage and they'll just go through your land and do whatever they want, because they will be given that authority. With the gas leak, to even think about the amount of gas leaks that are taking place right now in Springfield, it's mind blowing. Sorry, and it's in a way that, wow, like talking about pollution and talking about you know, issues that affect our environment, this is like a perfect one to address. And the best thing about environmental issues is that there's so many campaigns that we can take on. There's so much work to be done that everybody can be involved. You know, we not too long ago saw the huge when, you know, on Worthington Street, you know, that whole street blew, and thank God we didn't have any death, but just imagine if that would have taken place in front of any of our homes, how many that would have taken, and to think that it could happen. Just leave your stove on. You know, that's how I see it. There's like leaks. There's gas actually leaking right now, and that many. How dangerous is that? And why isn't nobody doing anything about it? And why are we not being transparent so that our residents know about it?
It's funny this question jumps out at me, because over the time that before I was elected, there was a lot of gas leaks going around in Springfield that caused warming centers to be opened, and, you know, people's homes couldn't be heated properly. Yeah, there was gas going in there, but, what, you know, and then they had to, that's when we started figuring out, even in the North End and Forest Park, that stuff was happening.
Yeah. So Adam, what you're describing is an effect of the over 500 gas leaks that exist in Springfield. So a little bit of background information on this issue. There are over 500 gas leaks that have been reported to the Department of Public Utilities by the gas company, the State Department of Public Utilities. They vary in size. So some of them are extremely small. Some of them are a little bit larger. We're told, or at least we hope, that they do not pose an immediate public safety threat. But we don't know that we can be guaranteed that. So where we get our information from is an organization called HEATMA, and they have a website, heatma.org, H-E-E-T, and they have a project called the Squeaky Leaks Project. And what they've done is actually mapped all of these gas leaks on a Google Maps image. And if you go on to heatma.org and click on the Squeaky Leaks Project, you can see where all the gas leaks are in your neighborhood or in your city. And I happened to do that when this issue was first introduced to me, and one of them is in front of my house, and it was a gas leak that we had reported, and they came out and worked on it, and they left, and the neighbors smelled it again, and we reported, and they came back and worked on it, and they left. And so this is what a lot of people are facing. And this is not just an issue in Springfield. It's an issue across Massachusetts. Right now in Northampton, they're also working on a campaign. Over 100 gas leaks exist in Northampton. But here's the really interesting thing about the gas leaks is that they do contribute to global warming. Also, they have the additive that gives natural gas. The smell that they add, mercaptan, we're told, is a neurotoxin. So when that's leached into the air, it can harm public health. But another issue is that the gas companies, as we understand it, are passing on the cost of all this lost gas to the ratepayers. And it's estimated in the millions of dollars per year of gas that's just being leaked, which means it's not being used to heat our homes, not being used for anything resourceful, but instead just being leaked into the air. But they're not paying for it. Mm-hmm. We are. And so the question is, who does that impact, right? Well, it impacts everybody. But if you have less money and you are being forced to pay more for your gas heating bills, it impacts you at a little bit of a greater percentage than folks who are higher income. So we have sent a letter to Columbia Gas. We are waiting for a response. We want to work with them. We want them to present a plan for to upgrade their infrastructure. We also want them to end the practice of charging ratepayers for this leaked gas. They should be responsible for it. It's their infrastructure. And there's two bills currently pending in the Massachusetts House of Representatives. One, which would make it illegal for Columbia Gas to charge us for the gas that's being leached into the environment. And the second, that would require, if we're going to dig up a public road for any sort of utility work anyways or any sort of repaving, that at the same time, we would upgrade the infrastructure under that road. So it puts us on a progressive track to improving the project. But it's a big issue. And it's all across the Commonwealth.
I will say we did get a response from Columbia Gas.
Well, it was the wrong Columbia Gas.
Columbia Gas, who called us up and said, why didn't you invite us to the forum? We would have been right there. And it turned out they were calling from Springfield, Ohio. I don't know how they heard about our particular campaign in Springfield, Massachusetts, but they said, we can be there in half an hour. I don't know what jet that would have been, but we did manage to get that straightened out with them. We're not in Ohio.
We very much hope to receive communication, though, from Columbia Gas, Massachusetts, and we look forward to the opportunity to work with them.
I just want to say that, you know, with the response on those times in the winter when some of those residents, you know, the mayor's office and Health and Human Services Commissioner Helen Calton, they move very swiftly in opening these warming centers for some of these families. And working with Columbia Gas, so they've tried their best to, you know, because sometimes it's hard for them to dig into the ground because of the winter. Mm-hmm. So I guess that has to do with some of the, you know, the challenges we have as global warming, because if it's still cold and the ground still can't be broken, you know, they can't really necessarily go in there and fix a lot of these leaks. I know a couple years ago in downtown, we had a building that kind of exploded because of a gas leak. Mm-hmm. And those are some of the challenges that we're trying to work with Columbia Gas, I believe, and make sure that this doesn't happen to residential homes. I know around the nation, we've seen out in California things of a big methane release into the air, and then we have buildings in other big cities that have blown up because of gas leaks. And the thing is, some of these pipelines and some of these gas leaks, gas lines were put together before our time, and a lot of them are starting to give way, and you know, we just got to go back in there hopefully and get those things fixed.
And you hit it right on, where, you know, we should not be, you know, sitting and just waiting until we hear about, you know, the next major gas leak. Mm-hmm. You know, knowing that these, you know, lines have, you know, are so old and are giving up on us, we should be on the streets right now, like repairing all of them. And I know it's going to be costly, but, you know, there's a lot of people waiting for jobs. Yeah. Like, you know, we have people ready to, like, get to work. So, I fail to understand how we cannot fix it, how we cannot work towards making sure that, you know, that we put people, you know, to work and getting these lines brand new so that it can last another 20, 30 years if that's what we choose to do. but discontinue to keep using the ones that we have when we already know that, you know, they're so old that they're already giving up on us, and any of our streets can explode at any given time. That's just not acceptable. And I will, you know, I just fail to understand that. Like, I'm not taking that in. And I push forward, and I think that, you know, we should continue to work with Columbia Gas. I know that it's a business, it's pro-profit, but nevertheless, we're the ones, the recipients of that, and we need to make sure that it doesn't affect our health and that we are, you know, working in collaboration.
Yeah, and I would say it is fair to acknowledge that Columbia Gas contributes to the community. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that goes with the job description of being a community organizer is, but what have you done for us lately? You know, we have to focus ourselves on the problems and try to balance them, you know, with the good things that do happen also. But there's a lot of work to be done, and we have to transition away from natural gas in any case. But in the meantime, let's do it right.
Just to move on our next question, recently a bill was introduced to increase the amount of solar energy. For some viewers and some people that are thinking about going green and going solar, if anybody wants to add, what are the benefits of a homeowner and a community going green?
You worked on that.
Yes, though not as closely as some of the other pending pieces of legislation. There's a lot happening this year. I think for one, you know, just to tap into my Yankee roots, it's energy independence. You know where your electricity is coming from, and you know that you're not contributing to energy, you know, injustice in other parts of our country. You know, whether it's fracking or it's coal, some community, some neighborhood somewhere, that is being extracted and having impacts on them. So when you have a solar panel on your roof or community solar in your neighborhood, you can point to it and know. you know, that's where this is coming from. The second piece of it is that sunshine is free. You know, so whenever the sun is shining, you are making energy. Sure, it doesn't, you know, shine all the time, but like I said, you know, enough sunshine falls on planet Earth in 1 hour to power for the whole year. So it's much more powerful than necessarily, you know, than I know I sunburn, but solar panels are more sensitive even than me. So I think, you know, it's important for those two kind of value-based reasons, it's important. And, you know, we want to be making sure that we're doing everything we can to be transitioning as quickly as possible away from every kind of fossil fuel. You know, we have no time to lose. Mm-hmm. So
I wanted to add, and again, going back to environmental justice, if someone like myself who lives in the North End wants, you know, the home to be solar, with, you know, solar panels, I need to, you know, invite my neighbors to do the same so it can have its effect, right? So we can all benefit from it. It can't be just me because I'm not going to benefit as much as a person or, a homeowner with other residents with solar panels. So we need to make sure, once again, that schools, municipal buildings, you know, state buildings are going green, that they also start, you know, making use of solar panels so that it can benefit, you know, homeowners, it can benefit, you know, our children or everybody. It'll benefit everybody, and it's going to benefit our pockets. It's going to benefit everywhere we go. So instead of us worrying about, you know, how am I going to pay for, you know, this bill, well, wow, my bill is like so low that now I can actually afford to buy a pair of socks, you know? So it makes a huge difference when we are all in this together, and that, you know, the solar is not just happening in one area of the city and not another.
Michael, I want to go back to something that Claire said, though, about for low-income people and people that are not homeowners, energy efficiency is the way to go. Springfield is, I think, 49% homeowners and 51% renters. Unless a landlord wants to make a major investment in solar panels, that leaves about half of our community out. Mm-hmm. So legislation that is crafted is going to have to be done in such a way that there's a way for low-income people to benefit, even if we can't have solar panels on our triple-decker or our apartment building. And I don't think that's been really figured out very well yet. Mm-hmm. And also, it can be the kind of issue that if you talk to low-income people, they say, oh, that's not about us. That's not for us. Mm-hmm. And that's completely understandable. So until we really dig in and look at these issues from an environmental justice perspective, well, we've got a lot of work to do to make that happen.
And Adam, it's also worth noting, and I also think we neglected to mention that State Representative Carlos Gonzalez, who was scheduled to be here with us this evening, got tied up with some budget votes in Boston. He wasn't able to make it back in time, but I personally think he's doing a great job in his first term. So we're glad to have him out there fighting for us and for the North End. But, you know, we know we had a conversation with him and with some other reps who had some concerns about the solar bill. And I know I won't be able to put as eloquently as he did, but in some way or manner, there was a large coalition of low-income organizations that ended up lobbying against the bill because in some way or form, the way the subsidy was written, it ended up putting the burden more on low-income communities than on higher-income communities. And so basically, high-income communities would have had their solar power subsidized in such a way that it was paid for by low-income communities. And so a lot of urban representatives felt that they couldn't support the bill. That is something that we need to be very conscious of when we're doing this type of organizing and trying to pass this type of legislation. That is absolutely upside down. It makes absolutely no sense that people who aren't going to be able to benefit from the cost savings or be able to benefit from the lower pollution levels would end up paying for it. And so I know that that's something that the environmental community is coming to terms with. I think with the environmental justice movement, there's a lot more attention being paid to that. Hopefully in the next round, we can figure out a funding mechanism that doesn't impact low-income communities and hopefully will actually benefit them down the line.
I just want to add, there's an increasingly large movement of groups pulling together to form what's called the 100% renewable energy for the 99%. Awesome. To really bring it for all. And I think that's exactly what we need to be working for. Is
yes.
Well, one thing I've realized with solar coming in, that the ones that kind of benefit from them, like Michael Land said, was people that own their own homes. And if you do own a two-family, only one of the units could get the energy. So, you know, if you did have a landlord that probably, hey, I'm going to go green and we'll work it out, I guess, in the end. You know, that's not the benefit towards somebody that's a renter. You know, personally, you know, we've gone green and we have solar panels. And some of these stuff to come into play, well, the problem was that people were getting these panels, but then in essence, it was hard for them to get them jump-started mm-hmm. because they had to wait for it to transition over from Eversource. I believe that's what it was. But the question that I think people need to understand is how these solar panels work. And Michael Ann said it when we were talking about the hydro plant that they're investing over there at Watershops Pond is the grid. How does each of these, you know, and then yesterday, as a matter of fact, at City Council, we just passed the bill for the a turbine to be built right there next to Bay State Medical. So then instead of 90 days of they're changing the way that they do their energy, that will be 30 days that they can stay sustainable. And it has to do with the resilience money that we were talking about earlier. And those are like three. That's why I asked that question. What are the different ways? So the viewers can understand what the grid is. How does each of these, you know, the hydroplane and then also the solar and then like a turbine situation work, and how does it pay into the grid, and what's the benefits of it paying into the grid when it's you versus it's like what she says, it pays into the city.
Yeah, go for that, Claire.
Okay, I mean, I'll do my best.
Yeah.
I mean, so the thing, so what is the grid? So the lights that are shining right here in the studio are connected through all the wires in one gigantic web for all of New England. We are one grid from Maine to Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Hampshire, Vermont, all six states. And so we have power plants, you know, whether it's coal-fired power plants or nuclear power plants or solar panels, all creating electrons, little packets of energy that then get pushed out into this web. And, you know, the idea around the grid is that there are enough electrons, enough little packets of energy moving around at all times that everybody can flick on the light if they need to. And so, you know, the amazing thing about solar panels is that they can go a million different places. And maybe, you know, I live on a triple decker in Boston. I'm a renter. I can't get a solar panel. But my parents, who are homeowners, they're able to get a solar panel on their home. And that benefits us because it helps fight climate change. When we can retire coal-fired power plants like Mount Tom and Holyoke here in the Pioneer Valley, we can clean up some of the air. People can breathe easier, have fewer asthma attacks, and we can create jobs. The solar industry, when it is not being held back by other, you know, bad policy decisions, when it's thriving, is one of the fastest growing job makers in our state. Let's put people to work, let's clean up the air, and let's get ahead on climate change.
Aside from these different ways of saving energy, is there any other, like as a renter, is there any other ways that people can invest into other things to save energy within their home?
I mean, the energy efficiency pieces are the best bang for your buck. I don't know if Michael and you want to.
I'm just getting into like LED lights, different things of that nature, using energy.
Sure. There are things that those of us that are renters can do. You know, there's going to be some limitations. I can't necessarily do much about my apartment if it's not well insulated. You know, I can't make those kinds of changes easily. Even putting plastic over all my windows isn't, besides the feeling of isolation, isn't really going to do much to save energy. The grid is something that we need to learn a whole lot more about, so I will say I'm not an expert, but every now and then you'll hear about someone, well, her house isn't even on the grid. In other words, it's energy independent because of solar panels or thermal energy, other ways to go. You can't do that in Springfield right now. You can't produce energy on your own. You have to be able to send what you don't use back to the grid. And if you can't find a way to do that, if the infrastructure isn't there, you can't do it. You can't get off the grid. You can't be energy independent. So this is something we have to really understand a lot better than we do. It's one of those things like the air that we breathe that we tend to take for granted. And we have to stop taking it for granted.
And not only understand it better, but ensuring that we're all on the same page as well. Like ensuring that, you know, that it's not just me and Michael Ann and the panel here trying to understand about solar panel and all that, but to make sure that the city is also on the same page. Again, like I mentioned earlier, to, you know, do the same thing with their building so that we can all benefit from it and you know, we can consistently have that approach and make sure that, you know, our own residents are benefiting from the local jobs that that's going to create.
Do you think it's safe to say that to our viewers and to our studio audience that before you do invest in solar panels, to understand the business and understand what's the benefits from it, and not just, you know, invest in it just because people are telling you to?
Oh, most definitely. If it wasn't because I have been attending the meetings and they've done, you know, many informational sessions about it, I would have been, you know, jumping in. It's like, well, how am I going to benefit it? Like, you know, where it's located and, you know, the neighbors around me and you know, I'm right on Plainfield, and, you know, it's like, you know, we need to all make sure that we are all doing the same thing so that we can all benefit. You know, it's every single one of us, the air that we breathe. It's going back into the climate. It's everything included. So if it, you know, you doing it alone, they're not gonna like make business out of it, money out of it. It's all of us doing it so that we can all benefit as well as the solar panel business can grow.
And Adam, I just wanna add, because I think these are really good questions. And I think they tie into a lot of what we've talked about tonight in terms of how do we engage populations that aren't traditionally engaged in this type of activity. Mm-hmm. And I get one of my colleagues here on the panel said, you know, this can't just be something that happens in the suburbs. It can't just be something that happens in the country, because the majority of people do not live in the suburbs and do not live in the country. And I think it, you know, especially hits home for us. I'll just say, you know, we're not outsiders. We don't have our heads in the clouds. Mm-hmm. I'm a renter. Mike Land's a renter. Claire's a renter. Yvette, I believe, is a homeowner, but it's all right. You know, and so, and we're proud of her for it. But a Rise for Social Justice, and I hope to be one someday, but a Rise for Social Justice is a low-income-led membership-based organization. I would dare to say the vast majority of our members are most likely not homeowners. And so these questions are questions that we want answered as well. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there has to be a point where, of course, you know, listen, Adam, you're on the city council. You're the representative from Ward 1. You have a lot of landlords in your district. Their top priority, oftentimes, is not to weatherize their homes. Their top priority is to collect their rent. That's their investment property. It's different when you own your home, and weatherizing is going to save you a bunch of money, and you're excited. So we need to figure out a way to incentivize these types of activities to make it not cost prohibitive for landlords, to make it something that they want to do. And that's going to be something that urban communities are going to have to address. It's something you guys are going to have to address on the city council, and it's something that you have cooperation from us to really make it happen in the city. So I think it's really great that we're asking these questions, because even if we don't have all the answers to them right now, we can go out and find them.
Well, can I just add, to take off that momentum, I think that's one of the reasons why it's so important that there is a place like the Springfield Justice Coalition, you know, working with the city to make climate justice plan, because it is larger than me and my apartment and my, you know, I can't do it on my own. But when we actually are able to engage with the city, engage with the state to actually change the way our laws are, you know, there's some big questions being debated in the State House. That's where the representative is tonight, on energy policy, on solar, on wind, on, you know, a tax for gas pipelines that I definitely don't support. So if, you know, one of the things you can, every single person can do is to call your local elected officials, call your state elected officials, and tell them that you want climate justice. Get involved with groups like these, because that's the thing that can help all of us, and especially the most vulnerable.
They love getting calls. Adam loves it.
Fantastic. I can attest that in the North End, it's funny that once we, my family got their solar panels, and I can say my family because my father, not me, I'm a renter also, but you know, across the street, then the funny thing is you see the next door neighbor then go get them, then the guy across the street, and then for houses down the line, you see people just start genuinely getting educated. Like, well, this guy got it. Let's try it out. And a lot of people now, it's like where I live in the North End, right in Brightwood section, a lot of the houses now are going green. And that's, you know, it's a really great question, because I can answer that because we're going through it. And as a renter, like what I can tell the viewers and the studio audience is that weatherization, you know, doing things like that and buying LED lights in your home are, if you can't get these solar panels because of, you know, the challenges that stop you, just try to figure out ways that, you know, you can at least prevent, you know, wasting energy. And I just want to give a big shout out to Focus Springfield that's invested a ton of money in buying LED lights for low energy use here in Springfield. You know, I just wanted to, you know, throw that out there since we're talking about energy saving energy. I'm going to move on to the next question. And this question is the business needs for sustaining our future. And I just want to tell you guys answering these questions is fantastic. I just want to tell you that we're moving along fine. And thanks everybody for being patient. And thank you again for listening into, you know, what's going on here in the Springfield when it comes to energy and our Climate Justice Coalition. What role can business play in the effort to combat global climate change locally? I'm going to answer it again because I know we're moving again. I'm going to say the question again. What role can businesses play in the effect, in the effort, I'm sorry, I apologize, in the effort to combat global climate change locally?
That's why I wish Representative Gonzalez had been able to be here, because he did some homework on this question, and he happens to be a founder and representative of the Latino Business Association. I think there's a real difference between small businesses and major corporations. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Eventually, I'd like to think that major corporations will understand it's in their own best interest to pollute less, and even if we didn't have climate change as a looming problem, I'm afraid our country would still be in trouble because of the level of toxic chemicals that are released every day, most of which have never been tested, and that we consume and that find their way into penguins in the Antarctic, even though they've never been produced there. The role of the mission of a corporation is to make money for its shareholders. And the larger a corporation gets, the more single-minded the focus on that issue. But small businesses, I think, really can get it. Locally owned businesses, they understand that what they do has an impact on the whole community, and they're part of the community, and they want to do the right thing. So I think small businesses are really going to make a big difference in Springfield, and we're working on a plan now to reach out to them and find out what they see are their barriers and what they see as incentives to recycling, using energy wisely, polluting less. I think we'll get some good answers and a lot of good cooperation.
I agree, Michael Ann, and I think that, we had mentioned before, although we do benefit from the reuse, recycle, that's not it. You know, we obviously have our hands into being able to do a lot more, and this is the best opportunity to do so. We're in that time where a lot of information is being provided to the residents and business owner. One great example where business can get involved in climate and environmental issues is on Saturday we're going to do the Great American Cleanup. We're going to be having our residents out on the streets. What a great opportunity for businesses to also do the same and, invite, their consumers to, help clean up or even invest in their products that they're going to offer their consumers to be energy efficient, to be green. That's a starter to provide information. There's so many ways that they can now get involved and be part of this movement it's amazing. It's just very nice. I think it's wicked cool. But, this is the in now. This is what's happening, and we will all benefit.
Yeah, I think we're on the right track.
Definitely.
Especially, in these strips where we have a lot of stores, bodegas mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. deal with single plastic bag use and, involving them more on this Great American Cleanup that's going on Saturday, not just in the North End, but it's going happening all over the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Keep Springfield beautiful. We're going to be in cleaning up parks. We're going to be cleaning up the streets, in different areas where there's stuff on the ground that you don't want your kids to touch. If you want to get involved, I think it's important. And some of these business owners, since we're on the business talk topic, I had a meeting with business owners in Ward 1, and it was, in Spanish, we call it like an orgullo, like a pride for your community, a pride for where you live. Mm-hmm. And the thing that I've seen that a lot of people in my neighborhood is some of these store owners that they take every morning, they come out, and they clean the front of their store, mm-hmm. So then I asked them and I challenged them to say, hey, how about we clean, if your neighbor's not doing it, try to tidy it up, and probably they'll get the drift to, you know, follow suit. Mm-hmm. And I guess that goes back to what I was talking about with solar energy. Like, once you see one person get them, mm-hmm. then, you know, you start following along and mm-hmm. start getting educated and start getting involved. Because some people, they don't like to be singled out. They have this feeling like, man, I don't want to be the only one. But sometimes you have to be that only one to lead by example mm-hmm. to make sure that people catch the drift, I guess.
Well, and I think the thing that you're getting at, that kind of Yvette touched on, is the sense that business owners are leaders in our neighborhoods, in our communities. I know when we were doing outreach around the biomass incinerator, you know, going into barbershops and nail salons and local mm-hmm. groceries and bodegas and talking to folks about the campaign and getting their support, and then knowing that, you know, some of them would put the sign in their window, or they would talk to the next person that they were cutting the hair of. Mm-hmm. Hey, have you heard about that biomass incinerator? You know, local business owners are visible people. Right. And so when they take initiative, it makes a ripple effect.
Right. I wanted to also add, an experience that I had when I went to a specific plaza, and my daughter was like, Ma, that's because the wind is bringing all the trash from the entire plaza, and it's accumulating in this one store. Like, all, like, and I was like, that's incredible. Like, and the fact that she was the one that noticed it, not me. But anyway, you know, it's all of it. And so if that particular store, instead of cleaning the front of their own store, they invite the rest of them to, like, do the same, maybe they would not be needing to clean up this gigantic amount of trash that accumulates when it's windy out, you know? So it's inviting everybody. And the same with, you know, with us residents and homeowners. Oh, you know, they always throw in trash. Well, maybe if they see you, or maybe if you let them know that you don't want the trash right there, like, can you please, you know, nicely, you don't have to be rude about it. Mm-hmm. Can you just, and it's just like the basic, like, you know, it starts with that level of commitment.
Yeah, Adam, you know, I would just add, too, I agree with Michael Ann when it comes to large corporations in our communities. You know, that's something that we have to demand good corporate responsibility. And they need to be partners in this. They've got the money to do it. Mm-hmm. And they do it in other communities. The stores that are going to be impacted by the larger stores are going to be impacted by the single-use plastic bag ban if it's successful in Springfield. Well, they're already impacted by single-use plastic bag bans throughout the country. They're impacted by single-use plastic bag bans up 91 in Northampton. So if they can do it there, they can do it here. Mm-hmm. But we, as an urban community, face different challenges when it comes to our small businesses. And even small businesses in outside urban communities, it's a little bit different. And I remember, I know this because I talked to people who had pushed single-use plastic bag bans in other communities. And I said, hey, you know, what do we do about small businesses? How do we handle this? And their response was, well, you know, you just have to tell them they have to do it because they just have to. I mean, ours did it. Our craft stores did it, and this and that. And I said, well, we're not dealing with craft stores, and we're not dealing with, you know, we're dealing with extremely small businesses, small family-owned businesses. A lot of immigrants own businesses in the city of Springfield, people who English is not their first language. Some of them don't speak English yet. So there's barriers to dealing with this, and the impact on them will be greater than it is in other communities. And so that's why it was so important to me and to us personally to make sure that as we craft our initiatives, those businesses don't suffer. And it's all about, similarly, we have to incentivize it for them. They have to get something out of it beyond sort of the larger scale things. It needs to impact their business well. And so, you know, that's something that we can work on with the Chamber of Commerce, with the Latino Chamber of Commerce, with the different business groups in the area is, you know, how can we make sure that these businesses get recognized for the steps that they're taking? It can be as simple as saying, hey, listen, you know, you've started for your small restaurants. Oh, you started composting? Well, let's get you a sticker to put on your door so that you can be proud of that, because that's what they're doing in the Upper Valley where the restaurants are being encouraged to compost. So it just comes down to incentivizing it and recognizing that it's not going to be as easy as it may be in other communities. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't pursue it.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to the next part of our program. I want to thank the panelists for all your answers. Now we're going to take some questions for our studio audience. I have a couple questions here that are written down. Bear with me. I'm going to read them out. And then if anybody wants to jump in, please do so. Our first question from our studio is, what are some things that Springfield residents can do at home to promote, sustain, ability, and save money?
I'm going to say one thing, although the solution is probably bigger than what we just do individually, and that is to avoid packaging. Avoid buying products that are all wrapped up in plastic and then another layer of plastic, and you have to go get your garden shears to try to get them open. They're not recyclable. They're going to go straight to the trash. You can bring bags to the supermarket so that you can get produce that you don't have to get the flimsy little plastic bags, or you can get them and then use them over and over again. So I think that's just one of the things that we don't have as much choice about as we should have. But if you've got a choice between two products and one is heavily packaged and the other isn't, go for the one that isn't heavily packaged. So that's one example.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to mention the reduce, reuse, recycle, and repair. And the reuse, you know, for many of us Latinos, we don't like that. You know, we like brand new, high class, you know, the one that has like the Fila and this and that. Listen, you know, let's make sure that we bring down a little bit the consumerism that is so much destroying this planet. And that we're able to, you know, reuse. My son is a perfect example that he was like, you know, 1 year old, 2 year old don't need that $40, $50, $60, $100 brand new outfit. You know, they can go and get it because they're gonna outgrow it within a week and within a month. And it's something that, you know, as simple as that, you know, will definitely have an impact, not just to the pocket, but to our environment.
So after you weatherize, call your state representative and state senator and tell them to get that bill passed that'll make it illegal for Columbia Gas to pass on the cost of the gas leaks onto your gas bill. Mm. And then also there's another bill pending in our state legislature to try and get ratepayers, people like you and me, to help pay for new gas pipelines. So also make sure that you tell them, heck no, the gas pipeline companies can pay for their own pipelines. Don't put that on my bill.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? All right, I'm going to get to the next question. We all know the importance of job creation in Springfield. When new industrial projects are planned, are there any environmental impact statements as for legal requirements before the project starts? For example, noise and traffic that affects the environment and the quality of life here in Springfield?
That's a really good question. I'm going to use the casino as an example. Although there was an environmental impact study, again, it met the bare minimum requirements. We really have no idea what the impact of all the traffic will be. The building that is being built meets the, I guess you could call it the LEED certified building, which means it meets some level of green standards, but not much. I was supposed to get information from MGM about the pollution impact of climate change, but somehow it just keeps getting passed on to somebody else in MGM, and I've never been able to get an answer. To go back to the biomass plant, the neighbors who are right around where the plant is proposed, they're less concerned about air pollution than they actually are, or air pollution from the smokestack, because as the developer said to them, don't worry, we're building a really tall stack. It's not going to pollute your neighborhood. It'll pollute over there. So they think about, though, the pollution from the number of trucks that are going to be delivering wood scraps to the plant, and also the pollution from those trucks and the noise. So those are concerns that I really think should be taken into consideration for any new construction. But we don't have those standards. And I remember once asking the Mass Department of Energy, I'm missing an initial there, it's DOER, why they were allowing a biomass plant to be built when we already had enough energy. And the answer was, we don't make those decisions, the market makes those decisions. Well, the market can make some pretty bad decisions.
Some of the things Mike Land's describing could be taken up and considered by the Springfield Public Health Council as it reviews the biomass incinerators application. So if those are things that you're concerned about, which I hope you are, you can always come out to those monthly meetings and have your voice heard.
Definitely, and the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition meeting. We definitely have to do more, and you know, this is a great start right here. These kind of forums and the monthly meetings that we held, because they're very informative. And, you know, the more information we are able to get, the better we are going to be able to advocate and for the right things, you know, and how to advocate for them as soon as we have the information. And, you know, we, Springfield and its residents, again, a lot of the bigger businesses that come and you know, try to get their license approved so that they can build here, you know, I'm hoping that they are going to be very transparent in issues like this one, and providing the information to its residents in terms of how it's going to really affect and not just, you know, promote based on just wanting to do make profit out of it.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to get to another question, and then we're going to wrap things up. Talking about the plastic bag use, question is, will there be a take on banning paper bags as well?
Paper bags, although they take time to compost, will compost. Plastic bags, doesn't matter what you read on them, where they say, if you look at the fine details, it'll say, under optimal conditions, this plastic bag will biodegrade in blank number of months. Well, you never get those optimal conditions because these plastic bags wind up in a landfill or wind up being burned. So, no, paper is much more recyclable, and we don't anticipate, we're not proposing any fee for paper in this ordinance.
And it's a good question, though, because the idea really should be that you want to be purchasing your own reusable bags, bringing them to the store when you do your big trips, and using those instead. That's why a lot of communities have imposed fees, and the idea is that the fee, which is usually 5 to 10 cents, for example, in Washington, D.C., where I went to college, so I paid the fee for a while, they impose the fee, and the fee actually goes into a fund that's used to clean up the rivers. Again, we're not proposing a fee, but the reason why they proposed that they instituted the fee is because they felt that it was the best way to actually get people, consumers, to change their habits. So if you don't want to pay the fee, then you buy recyclable bags. You can buy the recyclable bags for as low as a dollar. You buy 5 of those. Usually that can do your trip. You spend $5 now, but you don't continuously spend a dollar every time you go to the grocery store. The question is, right, how do we incentivize or how do we encourage that without a fee in Springfield, which is the goal? And part of that really has to come through campaigns that can be run, getting those small businesses on board, hooking them up with the resources to sell the bags. And, you know, who knows, maybe we can create a whole niche market where somebody can, you know, a local Springfield resident can make a whole lot of money getting those recyclable bags or reusable bags out. So it's really about being, it's really about changing your mindset and about being innovative.
And that's true for the consumer, too. Let me just start out. I try to remember to say in stores, no, I don't need a bag. Sometimes I forget, and sometimes they're ready to give me a bag before I've even asked for one. If I go, no, that's okay, I don't need a bag, 50% of the time, the clerk will then take the bag and throw it in the trash. And I'm like, no, wait, that's not why I said I don't want a bag. Same thing happened in Dunkin' Donuts the other day, where they were going to put 6 donuts in a cardboard box. And I said, no, you can just put it in one of the wax bags. So she'd already started to unfold the six box, so she throws it in the trash. I'm like, no, just fold it back up. No food. It's like we have to change our habits. I'm not usually a big fan of saying, oh, if we all just do the right thing, we can save the planet, because it's a lot bigger than our personal habits. It's about, you know, what we do collectively, but that shouldn't let us off the hook.
Yes.
Thank you. I think we have just our last question. We could just keep it kind of brief, just we're going to get close to finishing up, is what are some projects that the community members can join in on? What are the next steps in helping our air quality in Springfield? And are there proposals to support any buildings in green space in our town, or cleaning, repairing some of the rundown old buildings? And how can we help?
It's like five questions.
Yeah, I know.
Those are great questions.
Yeah.
Who asked that question? Yeah.
All right, let me think of which part of it. Again, I'm throwing out some examples that may not completely change our city right away. Guerrilla gardening. Is there a vacant lot near you? Get some sunflower seeds and throw it in there. You know, transplant a raspberry bush over there so at least it'll feed the birds, and maybe it'll help feed some people who walk by it too. We've got to get out of this right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing. I'm going to give you one quick example. Our school department recently established a system, a much better heating system and much more efficient than we had before. We've got a pretty good parks facilities and recreation department. They've taken the lead in many of the positive changes that have happened in Springfield, but they haven't been able to fully, and they can now, on a day when there's a snow day, can from a central area turn down the temperature in all of the schools and save energy, but they haven't been able to use it yet because too many of the Springfield buildings have a flat roof and they're worried about snow accumulation. So we just built a brand new school, and guess what it's got? A flat roof. So come on, let's start doing things that make sense by using the best possible science and best possible knowledge that we have.
Well, folks that want to get involved are always welcome to join us. You know, when I first got involved, you know, I'm not an environmentalist by training, right? You know, I'm going to school for political science. But I got involved with Arise, you know, 6 years ago, and now I'm proud to work on the staff. The Springfield Climate Justice Coalition is a coalition of organizations, but we're also a coalition of individual members. And so our next meeting is Wednesday, June 1st. It's coming up 6 o'clock in the evening at the Arise for Social Justice office, 467 State Street. Everybody's welcome to come learn a little bit more about what we're doing, the campaigns that we have, and how you can get involved. If you got any questions about that, you can give me or Frank Cincotta a call at Arise, 413-734-4948. I know we're running out of time. I do just want to, you know, while I have the mic, thank, you know, everybody who came out tonight. And also I want to thank the folks at Focus Springfield, Steve Cary, John Abbott, Brendon Holland, the whole team. This is what community organizing looks like. This is what community activism looks like. And without the folks that are here tonight and the efforts that are being put in, we wouldn't have the action that we have in Springfield. We wouldn't be in the position to lead the cause of urban communities across the United States if it wasn't for what's going on here tonight. So thank you all very much.
All right. I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to thank the panelists. I want to thank our audience members. I want to thank Focus Springfield. I also want to thank our viewers at home that stayed with us the entirety of this program. And again, I just want to reiterate that a community meeting that's happening on June 1st at 467 State Street at Arise. It's the next Climate Coalition meeting. Also on May 4th, the Attorney General's has a listening session at 6 p.m. at the UMass Center at 1500 Main Street. So please, please get involved, get together with Arise, with the Climate Coalition, with the Justice Coalition. This is very important. This is our city. This is home. I believe as a whole that we've asked and brought awareness to a couple of things that are affecting our city and region. And as a whole, Creating real change in our city will begin with real unity. And this is where it starts. Mm-hmm. I believe our health problems isn't just one specific group or one specific area or one specific citizen, but in contrary, the whole Pioneer Valley. Let's work together in harmony to bring better quality of life for today, tomorrow, and for the generations to come. Thank you, and have a good night. Stay blessed. And if you want to get in contact with the Climate Justice Coalition, again, springfieldclimatejustice@gmail.com or call Arise at 413-734-4948. Thank you, and have a great night.